Welcome everyone to today's webinar. We'll wait just a couple minutes for folks to join. Welcome everyone, thanks for joining today. We'll wait just a little bit longer for more to join before getting started. All right, I think we will get started. So thank you all for joining today. This webinar series is Conversations on Ocean Carbon, a US West Coast and Alaska Perspective. It's co-hosted by the California Current Acidification Network, or CCAN, the Alaska Ocean Acidification Network, and the California Ocean Science Trust, with the aim to deliver the best available information on marine carbon dioxide removal, or mCDR, and to explore concepts related to coastal ocean carbon. Thanks to those of you who have joined us for any of our last two webinars, which can be found on YouTube. My name is Lauren Linsmeyer, and I'm a senior science officer with the California Ocean Science Trust. And I'm joined today by my co-hosts, Darcy Dugan with the Alaska Ocean Observing System and the Alaska Ocean Acidification Network, who's also going to be moderating the Q&A portion of the webinar. Alex Harper, who's the coordinator of the California Current Acidification Network, and Natalie Lord with NOAA's Ocean Acidification Program, who's helping make sure our platform is running smoothly. We are working together to create dialogue among industry members, tribes, natural resource managers, and scientists throughout the West Coast and Alaska to provide a better understanding of mCDR technologies, state of the science, and ways to become engaged. During today's webinar, attendees will be in listen-only mode. You can type questions into the question box at the bottom of your control panel, and we will post them to the speakers after their talks. We'll also be doing a few poll questions throughout to help inform this webinar series, and we're recording this session, and we'll share that recording on YouTube. We're also going to try something new this time. So if you have any announcements or updates you'd like to share with this community related to mCDR, whether it's new publications, funding opportunities, or other information, please feel free to put that in the question box, and the hosts will share that information with everyone at the end. The title of today's session is A Closer Look at Ocean Alkalinity Enhancement. We have three ocean chemistry experts joining us today to share about the science of ocean alkalinity enhancement, or OAE, how it works, why it's receiving attention as an mCDR strategy, and potential impacts being studied. After about an hour of presentations, we'll move on to a moderated Q&A for the final half hour. Before we start, we'd like to ask our first poll question to get a sense of how much our audience is tuning in to this series for the first time. Thanks, everyone. Maybe just tuning in for letting us know whether this is your first webinar in this series you're attending, or if you've been to one or both of our previous ones. Okay, great. Welcome to everyone who's new here. Grateful to have you. We can close that poll. And now I would like to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Andrew Dickson. Andrew is an emeritus professor of marine chemistry at the Scripps Institution of Oceanography at the University of California, San Diego. His research interests include ocean acidification, quality control of oceanic carbon dioxide measurements, biogeochemistry of the upper ocean, marine inorganic chemistry, thermodynamics of electrolyte solutions at high temperatures and pressures, and analytical chemistry of carbon dioxide in seawater. Phew! His laboratory at Scripps prepares, certifies, and distributes reference materials for ocean CO2 measurements to laboratories all around the world. So thanks, Andrew. I'll pass it to you now for your presentation.
Thank you very much, Lauren. Appreciate it. So I thought I'd start today by asking first, what we really mean by these terms. First, marine carbon dioxide removal. This is an expression that's kind of come up in the literature over the last 15, 20 years, but certainly a lot more in the last 3 or 4 years. And essentially, marine carbon dioxide removal approaches aim to enhance or accelerate natural biological or chemical processes that remove carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and sequester it in the oceans. Ocean alkalinity enhancement is itself a chemical process that involves adding alkaline substances to seawater so as to increase the ocean's ability to take up carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. So you can see that basically the overall idea is the removal of the carbon dioxide from the atmosphere with ocean alkalinity enhancement, changing the composition of seawater in such a way that it would increase the amount of carbon dioxide it takes up. So why would one want to remove CO2 from the atmosphere? Well, simplistically, one can look back at this classic curve started by a former colleague of mine at Scripps, Charles David Keeling, measuring the CO2 levels in the atmosphere at Mauna Loa on the island, Big Island of Hawaii. And the striking thing here are twofold, I feel. The clear seasonal picture that you can see, but also the seemingly incessant growth in the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere. And we've come to realize that as the CO2 levels in the atmosphere increase, this has implications for the radiative balance of the planet, and thus potentially for the climate in various regions of the world. If one looks back at what really happens to the CO2 that we're putting into the atmosphere, recall we're putting CO2 into the atmosphere in two different ways. On the left-hand side, fossil fuel burning, where fossil fuel are things like coal or oil or natural gas. And we're burning that fuel not just because we like burning things, but rather to get the energy from it to improve our quality of life. That's about 89% of the total CO2 that went into the atmosphere originally in about the last 10 years. In contrast, modifying land use by clearing land and planting crops and the like is about a further 10%. So of all the CO2 that was put into the atmosphere in those 10 years, almost half actually stayed in the atmosphere. The remainder went either into plants on land or into the oceans. So here, what we're talking about really is, can we change the proportion that goes into oceans such that less stays in the atmosphere? And a simplistic diagram that suggests this is here. The early part of that blue curve is our yesterdays. We are increasing every year the amount of CO2 that goes into the atmosphere. So now it's up almost at 40 gigatons, 40 billion tons of carbon dioxide added into the atmosphere each year from land use changes and burning fossil fuels. We recognize that that's a problem, and the ideal goal is that we did not put CO2 into the atmosphere. And that's this concept of net zero. And here, a suggestion is, if we were to have it so that the climate stayed below 1.5 degrees of average global temperature increase, then we would have to stop increasing how much CO2 we put into the atmosphere each year and drastically decrease it, following down that blue line. But the difficulty is that if we're to maintain our current lifestyles, we're using energy, we're using things that put CO2 into the atmosphere. And it's hard to imagine a time when that would not happen at all. And therefore we need this separate green part, which is we actually need to think about taking CO2 out of the atmosphere to make up for the CO2 that we couldn't help putting in, or in order to keep our lives the way we like them. So what happens when you're adding CO2 to seawater? Well, you start off with a CO2 molecule in the air. This can dissolve into the ocean. In the ocean, it reacts with water to form bicarbonate ion. And those of you that are comfortable with chemical stoichiometry will notice there's another hydrogen missing, because we also form hydrogen ion. But that's not the whole story. In fact, nearly all of that hydrogen ion that is formed from that acid dissociation to get the bicarbonate reacts with carbonate ion in the seawater to form still more bicarbonate. So this is the total process that you see adding CO2 to seawater. And strictly, you can look at this in the more chemistry style as reversible chemical equilibria, where the top one is the solubility, the next one, that first dissociation constant for CO2 going to bicarbonate, and the second, almost the backwards reaction for the second dissociation constant of bicarbonate going to carbonate. The sum of these all together give you that bottom reaction, which also has an equilibrium constant. And if you look at that, you can see that realistically, as you increase the CO2 in the atmosphere, it's going to dissolve in the oceans. It's going to react with carbonate ion, reducing the carbonate ion concentration in the oceans and increasing the amount of bicarbonate. The ratio of carbonate and bicarbonate are related, as you can see in the equilibrium constant on the right, to how much hydrogen ion is present. That is the acidity of the seawater. A consequence of this chemical equilibrium, therefore, is that the composition of the seawater must change in accordance with this reaction stoichiometry and the mass action expression, those equilibrium constants, if we're to ensure a decrease in the atmospheric CO2 mole fraction. So we can write here this expression, just rearranging one of those terms I showed before, which points out that the mole fraction of CO2 in the atmosphere is directly related to the first term, which is approximately constant. The equilibrium constants are functions of salinity and temperature. And so those change on with different processes from this particular reaction. And the pressure, which is, it's right there at the sea surface, it's roughly 1 atmosphere pressure. Or we could just take out the K2 from this and look at this, and we go, fair enough. It's therefore, if we want to get the mole fraction of CO2 smaller, we need the hydrogen ion concentration smaller. Bicarbonate, you can't change by as big a fraction. And so at equilibrium, at particular salinity, temperature, pressure, the mole fraction of CO2 in the atmosphere can most easily be reduced by approaches that reduce the amount content of the hydrogen ion in the seawater. Simplistically, making the seawater more alkaline. I put alkaline in those inverted commas to emphasize that it's not strictly just that hydrogen ion, because you've got that bicarbonate term there as well. And you have to worry instead about a term that we think of as the total alkalinity of the seawater. Total alkalinity is a somewhat strange and wonderful concept, which, had we but willed enough in time, I could probably waste another hour of your day telling you why it makes sense. But for now, please assume it makes sense. And reading through this paragraph, you'll see that the key feature is alkalinity is a conservative variable, both on mixing, that is two seawaters of different alkalinities, you know the final alkalinity just simply by the proportions of those two seawaters. And for changes in temperature and pressure, it doesn't change if the temperature changes. It doesn't change if the pressure changes. It really changes because of biogeochemical processes that affect the acid-base composition of seawater itself, but not by exchanging carbon dioxide between seawater and the atmosphere. So measurements of total alkalinity can be used to help study these biochemical processes and also to do calculations on the seawater system. And as we'll see, modifying the total alkalinity can change the uptake of CO2 from seawater, from the atmosphere. So here's a rather messy looking diagram where I have plotted on the y-axis the total alkalinity of a seawater sample and show it over a range of total alkalinities, and on the x-axis the total dissolved inorganic carbon. That's the sum of the amount contents of the dissolved CO2 gas, the bicarbonate ion and the carbonate ion. And if you add sodium hydroxide to a seawater, essentially you go vertically up that red line. You're increasing the alkalinity, you are not changing the total carbon. If you add sodium carbonate, you're going up that black line, which means for each mole of extra carbon, the carbonate ion, you got 2 moles of alkalinity. So that's at an angle of 60 degrees. If you added bicarbonate, it's pretty well a diagonal line. You can barely see it on this figure. I apologize for that. But the striking thing here is all the isolines are the lines of constant PCO2, that is the product of the mole fraction of CO2 in the atmosphere and a pressure of approximately, let's say, 1 atmosphere. So those lines, if you look carefully, there is an angle greater than 45 degrees, which means that if you're going to take up, if you add alkalinity, you go vertically up that red line. Let's imagine you started at a point where the red line crosses the blue line. The blue line is where the PCO2 is about today's level of about 425 microatmospheres. If you start there, you go up on the red line, then in principle, you could add extra CO2, i.e. a horizontal line, by taking CO2 out of the atmosphere until the PCO2 returned up. You see, notice as you go up, the PCO2 values go down. You go up that red line. If you go horizontally across, the PCO2 values are increasing again. When you reach the blue line again, that's as much as you will do to get to the equilibrium point. Because those lines at an angle greater than 45, you will necessarily take up less CO2 than the amount of alkalinity that you actually added to the seawater. So how can one add alkalinity to the seawater? Well, a variety of suggestions have been made for these alkaline substances, a number of categories. One, naturally occurring silicate minerals such as olivine. This reacts with seawater and essentially making it a little more alkaline. Man-made chemicals, the easiest to think about, and I showed that in some ways by using those on my previous diagram. Chemicals such as lime, calcium oxide, or slaked lime, which is calcium hydroxide, washing soda, which is sodium carbonate, or magnesium hydroxide. I've given these as examples because they've all been talked about. The lime ones have a long history of people taking lime. The hazard, of course, with lime is that you have to actually make it, usually by baking calcium carbonate until it loses the CO2. So you're kind of not really getting much if you then put it back in the seawater to get the CO2 back again. And then there are some industrial waste products, steel slag, which ends up as a mixture approximately of calcium oxide and calcium hydroxide. So there's a variety of materials you can add to the seawater. In each case, the material reacts with the seawater to increase both its pH and its total alkalinity. Hence, ocean alkalinity enhancement. You've increased the amount. But what might go wrong? Well, the primary requirement is that the modified seawater, the one that has had its alkalinity enhanced, must remain in contact with the atmosphere for a sufficient length of time to absorb as much carbon dioxide as it can. That means it has to stay right at the surface of seawater. If you think about what right at the surface really means, it means that the seawater density can't increase such that that water sinks. And yet you've changed its composition by adding materials to it. And so you've got to be careful that you don't increase the seawater density sufficiently to compromise the water actually staying with that composition at the surface so it can have an effect on the atmosphere. Another problem, if you put too much in, is you can get other things precipitating. If you add sodium hydroxide to a seawater, you're going to start precipitating calcium carbonate and ultimately magnesium hydroxide. These secondary precipitates limit the effective amount of the alkaline substance you've even added to the seawater. It's like you're taking away that alkalinity by precipitating further. Third, you take this alkaline substance, you dissolve it in seawater, you're changing the composition of the seawater. If it's pure sodium hydroxide, is that a problem? Probably not. But I also mentioned the industrial waste products, such as the slag, and natural minerals, such as olivine. So it's quite conceivable that other materials, not CO2 system based, will dissolve in the seawater. And these could cause possibly undesirable biogeochemical or ecological side effects. And it's going to be essential to monitor our early experiments carefully to ensure that it's to ensure that these effects don't show up. And finally, there's this area of marine CDR referred to as monitoring, reporting, and verification. And simplistically, there's two reasons to do this. One is to make sure you actually did what you planned to do. Well and good. But the second has the fact that if it's going to play a significant role in reducing the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere, this will have to happen on a huge industrial scale, sequestering billions of tons of CO2. This is almost certainly going to require some form of economic incentive to hasten the development and the adoption of marine CDR. But two difficulties exist in quantifying the value. First, how well do you really know how much CO2 went into the ocean? And you can figure out how much alkalinity you put in by the number of tons of rock or sodium hydroxide or magnesium hydroxide, whatever. But you don't know that it actually reacted quantitatively to reach an equilibrium point, because the water mixes and goes away from where you made the addition. It need not stay at the surface. So how well do you really know how much CO2 is taken up? If I was going to say to you, I'll give you $100 per ton of CO2, I'd want to be very sure that we knew how many tons of CO2 really were changing location between the atmosphere and the ocean. And second, even when CO2 is absorbed from the atmosphere, remember we said these are natural processes that we are enhancing. Even when the CO2 is absorbed from the atmosphere, it won't stay in the ocean forever. Really, it will have a residence time distribution, with some CO2 going back out into the atmosphere again quite quickly, and some fraction remaining behind. So we have this imaginary rainbow, CO2 at the end of it. And I'll give you a quotation that I like from Douglas Adams, which I think is a cautionary one. We're stuck with technology, when what we really want is just stuff that works. Thank you.
Great, thanks so much for your presentation, Andrew, and that grounding in carbonate chemistry of the ocean. So next we'll do a quick poll question before moving to our second speaker. In the meantime, please feel free to add any questions for Andrew to the question box in the control panel. All right, so Natalie will pull up our next poll question, which is to help us get a sense of where our audience is tuning in from today. Great, we can probably close that poll question and see where everyone's from. All right, thanks all. Now I'll introduce our next speaker, Dr. Burke Hales. Burke is a professor in the College of Earth, Oceanic and Atmospheric Sciences at Oregon State University, where his research interests include coastal ocean carbon cycles, ocean acidification, and measurement and experimental manipulation technology. He also invented the Burkeolator, an instrument that tracks ocean acidification in real time. With that, I will pass it to you, Burke.
Thank you. And I want to say that I'm having trouble with my audio, the word sometimes just mutes randomly. So if you don't hear me, that's what's happened. And please let me know some way or another. All right, so thank you very much, Andrew, for providing the background that's so essential to discussing this this really important topic. And I'm going to go into a little bit more applied perspective here and talk about, you know, whether or not we can do it, whether or not there's evidence that we can do it in a way that is beneficial and doesn't have a long-term net negative effect with potential unintentional releases of carbon dioxide. So we all promised to do fewer stoichiometric equations and slides like this, and so mine are going to be much simpler than Andrew's. There is a natural process. There's a natural process that adds alkalinity to the ocean, and it's the fundamental weathering reaction. And in very, very simple form, we start off with basic rocks, primarily produced igneously, volcanically, and their reactions with water and an acidic gas such as sulfur dioxide, hydrogen chloride, or importantly carbon dioxide reduces the weathered rocks, and then these anions that are the alkaline species, bicarbonate in this list being the one that is actually alkaline. And when we talk about alkaline, we're talking about species that react in an acid-base sense under the sort of normal range of conditions of natural waters. It's a very long timescale process, and this is one of the features of ocean alkalization that is significantly better than many of the photosynthetic uptake approaches. Alkalinity has a residence time in the ocean that ranges between 10 and maybe 500,000 years, depending on your perspective and depending on the processes that respond to perturbations. Ultimately, the tectonics of the Earth, subduction of seafloor plates, uplift, the volcanism that results from that produces these reactants, the new rocks that are basic, but also the acidic gases that weather them and release the alkalinity into the ocean water. As Andrew said, carbon dioxide in a much simplified form reacts with carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. This blue squiggly line represents the air-sea interface. And in the water, we've got aqueous CO2, dissolved carbon dioxide, which is the most acidic form of carbon that exists in the seawater. It reacts directly with carbonate ion in a simplified version of the reactions that Andrew showed to produce bicarbonate. Carbonate ion is the most alkaline form of carbon. Bicarbonate is a less acidic form of carbon, and it's actually, when we look carefully at its chemistry and its dissociation relative to pH of ocean water, it's a little less basic than ambient background ocean water. But the reduction of carbon dioxide is not our only, atmospheric carbon dioxide is not our only problem. Ocean acidification is happening, and it's a now problem. And I'm putting up some quotes and some images of folks we've worked with in the shellfish industry. And these are folks specifically at the Whiskey Creek Shellfish Hatchery, where we really were sort of at ground zero of this actual experience in the now of the ocean acidification problem. Mark Wiegert, owner of Pearl Point Oysters, and husband of Sue Cudd, who's the owner of Whiskey Creek Shellfish Hatchery, is no tree-hugging environmentalist. Mark is highly skeptical of much of the climate work. And he's got a famous quote that I'm paraphrasing here because I couldn't find it written, where he said, "I never believed all that global warming stuff, but ocean acidification is real." Sue, hatchery manager and owner of Whiskey Creek Shellfish, after we started putting monitoring equipment in the hatchery there, and we tried to take equipment out to go support us on a research cruise studying carbon dioxide distributions in the coastal waters, said, "If you take that instrument out of my hatchery, I'll go out of business." And Alan Barton, who really was the one who made the connections between the hatchery experiences and the research community, has a really famous quote where he says, "You know, yeah, we're experiencing these problems first because of the physical and biogeochemistry of the upwelling regions of the California current system." And Alan said, "We're being called the canary in the coal mine, and being the canary in the coal mine is nothing." Excuse me.
Hey, Burke, sorry to interrupt. Yeah. Before you move to your next slides, I think they might be a little off center of the screen. If it's possible to shift them down and to the right a little bit. Yep, that's better. A little bit down.
Is that better? Okay.
Apologies. A little bit down as well.
A little bit down.
I think just the title. Yep. I think that's better. Okay. Thank you.
Is that better? Okay. Thank you. Alan's quote is that there's nothing to celebrate about being the canary in the coal mine because the canary dies. So that leads us to this ocean acidification effect. Once that carbon dioxide gets into the seawater, exchanging with the atmosphere to increase the aqueous carbon dioxide in seawater, it reacts with water itself to form bicarbonate ion, and then this acidic hydrogen ion, which is the mechanism by which seawater is acidified by CO2 invasion from the atmosphere. If we can reduce the level of carbon dioxide in the water, either by reacting with alkaline species such as carbonate ion, or by reducing the atmospheric CO2 in the air, then we reduce the aqueous carbon dioxide in the water, we reduce the acidic reactions, and we reduce the effects of ocean acidification. And this is a problem that is somewhat independent from the problem of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. We could reduce carbon dioxide in the atmosphere to a great extent and make the ocean much more acidic in the process, and that's something we need to avoid. So can it work? Our experience is that it can, and it does, and it has. This paper, group of us, led by Alan Barton, wrote this paper about the Whiskey Creek shellfish hatchery story. And to go very high level, summarily over the story, in the late 2000s, the commercial shellfish industry in the Pacific Northwest collapsed. There was effectively no natural production of larval seed stock that would go to the oyster farmers, and the hatcheries themselves failed to produce any viable seed stock. None of the usual suspects were to blame. There were suspicions of viral pathogens, microbial attack, toxins, a number of these other things. None of these appeared to be evident, and none of the remedies that would typically mitigate those problems worked. Alan Barton happened to go to a conference where Richard Feeley was presenting results showing the high carbon dioxide chemistry of the Pacific Northwest waters that come into Neatarts Bay, where Whiskey Creek is located. And working with us and folks at PMEL, found that the issue was ocean acidification. The larval oysters, when spawned in high carbon dioxide waters that were unfavorable for the production of calcium carbonate shells that they depend on, were failing. They were dying when spawned in these waters. And after identifying the life stage and the mechanism in combination with our monitoring measurements, we set about an alkalinity enhancement experiment where we use commercially available soda ash, which is the commercial name for the sodium carbonate that Andrew just showed you. And this entirely restored the productivity of this industry. So we can do it. It can work. Unfortunately, the odds are not in our favor. There are two things that weathered minerals must be in order to be effective in alkalizing seawater, reducing the effects of ocean acidification, and potentially consuming more carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. The weathered minerals must be more alkaline than seawater, and they must be soluble in seawater at meaningful rates. And unfortunately, there are no abundant naturally occurring minerals that meet these objectives. Baking soda, which produces the bicarbonate that Andrew was discussing, is a little less alkaline than background seawater. Background seawater has about 10 or 15% more alkalinity than carbon dioxide. And baking soda, sodium bicarbonate, has equivalent alkalinity and carbon dioxide. If we push the ocean towards being more carbon rich relative to the alkalinity, even if the alkalinity itself is increasing, we make the ocean more acidic. We tend to cause reductions in carbonate ion. We tend to cause increases in carbon dioxide and decreases in ocean pH. Calcium carbonate, which is the reactive ingredient in Tums, is not soluble enough in any of the waters that are relatively important. They are connected to the atmosphere or coastally important where these sensitive populations are living. So they don't work, and we're set in a situation where we have to trick the thermodynamics. Like Sisyphus, we're having to roll the rock up the hill so that we can ultimately take advantage of the rock rolling back down the hill in our favor. We have been producing soluble basic minerals as humans for centuries, if not millennia. The picture on the left here is a traditional lye production process. Burning biomass can produce basic ash, potash or soda ash. That soda ash can be added to water and cooked down to further produce lye or sodium hydroxide, which is the active ingredient in Drano. And this is ultimately the precursor to making soaps and traditional products. But all of these processes end up being net CO2 positive. When you burn biomass, it releases carbon dioxide. When you heat up soda ash or potash, the product of that biomass burning, it releases carbon dioxide. And there's massive amounts of energy required in all of these steps, which for the most part, historically, causes release of carbon dioxide. But as an engineer myself, I'm highly appreciative of the thought that has gone into many of the processes that are involved in producing these chemicals in ways that are potentially lower in release of unintended byproducts. Currently, most soda ash, sodium carbonate, including the sodium carbonate that we used at Whiskey Creek Shellfish Hatchery to improve the water chemistry and resolve the shellfish seed stock crisis, is produced by a process called the Solvay process. And the two primary products from the Solvay process are sodium chloride, which is abundant in seawater, and calcium carbonate or magnesium carbonate, which is abundant in limestones and dolomites. If these two can be reacted to carry out what appears to be a very simple reaction, sodium chloride plus calcium carbonate can be reacted together to produce sodium carbonate and calcium chloride. Sodium chloride and calcium carbonate are abundant. Calcium carbonate is sufficiently alkaline. Sodium carbonate is sufficiently alkaline and will dissolve in seawater, and calcium chloride is a relatively harmless byproduct of the process. Unfortunately, it's never thermodynamically favorable. There is no circumstance under which calcium carbonate should react to form sodium carbonate. And so the process involves a number of steps, heating up the raw calcium carbonate, which releases carbon dioxide and produces calcium oxide. But then a number of intermediate steps where that carbon dioxide is reacted with sodium chloride and ammonia to produce bicarbonate and a secondary carbon dioxide product, which is also recycled. And ultimately, the end product, with a lot of energy and a lot of reaction process separation, has to ends up with the desirable result, sodium carbonate, which is soluble and sufficiently alkaline, and calcium chloride. But where does the energy come from? Well, mostly, historically, it has come from fossil energy products. What about hydrolysis? Hydrolysis has been a very popular topic in terms of potentially altering seawater chemistry to produce alkalinity, potentially directly from water itself. And with proper electrode selection and direct current voltage tuning, there are a number of electrochemical reactions that can happen in seawater, including hydrolysis of water itself. This reaction has been highly sought after as a potential avenue for producing clean hydrogen fuel, but it additionally produces alkaline hydroxide on one side of the reaction. Unfortunately, the other side of the reaction produces an equivalent amount of neutralizing hydrogen ion. And so the net effect from an alkalinity producing perspective is none. There is no alkalinity produced from the simple hydrolysis, electrolysis of water. And it gets even trickier when you get into seawater because you can potentially, without careful monitoring and control of the electrolysis process, you can actually produce highly toxic products like chlorine gas. Alternatively, if you can combine the weathering and the electrolysis process, there's the potential to take a limestone or a basic mineral slurry and react it with the acidic side of the electrolysis cell, potentially neutralizing the released acid and also providing a microenvironment where the insoluble the minerals that would be insoluble in seawater are soluble in this acidic reaction volume. The recombined solution includes dissolved minerals, their alkaline forms, and neutralization of the hydrogen ion that's produced on the acidic side of the reactor. We still have the energetic problem. We need to know how to make these processes happen without combusting fossil fuels in a way that releases carbon dioxide. But there is hope in this way as well. There are a number of non-CO2 generative processes, renewable energy forms, and it turns out that a number of these reaction sequences and schemes work well with renewable energy forms. So essentially, we're giving Sisyphus a jet boost to get this rock up the hill so that we can recapture the effect of it rolling back down. Challenges. There are a number of challenges, and these are not sufficiently appreciated. The scale, and Andrew spoke about this earlier, the scale is hugely, hugely challenging. Since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, nearly 2,000 gigatons of carbon dioxide, 2,000 billion tons, 2 trillion tons of carbon dioxide, and nearly 600 of that has accumulated in the ocean. If we were to just neutralize the CO2 that has been released into the ocean, we would need to mine 1,400 billion tons of calcium carbonate, transport it to the reactive locations, power the reactors, dissolve it, and that only takes care of the carbon dioxide that's currently in the ocean. Global alkalization on a scale such as this is not likely to occur, even with the economic and political will, just because of the scale. It took us, inadvertently, took us 150 years to mine these 2,000 billion tons of carbon dioxide in the form of fossil fuels. doing this, shifting our approaches, our industrial approaches over to mining calcium carbonate is not something that's going to happen in any immediate sense. Andrew also spoke about the back reactions. The ocean is already supersaturated with respect to these basic minerals. If we add alkalinity back to the ocean, it becomes even more so. At some point, these minerals will spontaneously precipitate. That precipitation exactly cancels out the alkalization that you were trying so hard to implement, but it also has ecosystem effects. The image on the left shows a satellite image of some natural whiting events. Whiting events are when calcium carbonate starts to precipitate spontaneously in seawater. And not only does this negate the effects of alkalization, but it has significant ecosystem effects in that visual predators can be negatively harmed. This happened in the case of coccolithophore blooms in the Gulf of Alaska, where the seabirds were unable to actually see their prey because of the release of calcium carbonate particles into the ocean, changing the water's optical clarity. Monitoring, reporting, and verification. In order to make this work, particularly in the context of this environment, which I will say has a lot of uncareful players involved. There are a number of folks who think that there's a silver bullet that just hasn't been discovered yet, and they're not taking any of these kinetic, thermodynamic, scale, ecosystem effects into account. The important thing is that not only do you propose an approach that should be net carbon dioxide negative, net ocean acidification mitigative, but you have to be able to verify that what you've done has worked. The challenge is that measuring alkalinity is something that is highly difficult at appropriate levels of precision and accuracy. Folks like Andrew Dickson is the best in the world at this. But there aren't very many Andrew Dicksons, and we need an army of them to be able to do this. The technology for making these measurements at the current time is not rapid. It's not automated. It's not rapid. It's not automated. And it requires measurement approaches that can capture the entire suite of carbon dioxide parameters in the ocean in such a way that we know what the true effect has been. Even that measurement itself, if you can make it adequately, is a large background. And what we're talking about doing is perturbing that system to a small degree to change the acid-base chemistry and increase the uptake of carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. And so now we're not talking about just measuring the total background, but small perturbations to that. Finally, we have no idea currently what the regulatory procedures are. We've never undertaken an intentional modification of seawater carbon dioxide or seawater chemistry like we're proposing now. And there will be significant challenges in getting through the regulatory process to do this in a careful and accountable way. There are global ecosystem effects. I know Debora is going to talk about the ecosystem effects in the ocean in her following talks, but this is a picture of a mountaintop removal mine that was done to extract coal, which is largely what got us into this problem. If now we're replacing mountaintop removal for coal extraction with mountaintop removal for carbonate mineral extraction, it's hard to say that we've made progress. So final thoughts, we can mitigate the harmful effects of present day ocean CO2 on local scales. There are complicated limits of physical chemistry that can be understood and overcome. We've shown this. And there are several promising procedures that can make these processes net CO2 negative. Unfortunately, the scale of global mitigation is daunting, with several additional challenges that need to be overcome. And again, I can't emphasize this enough. There are charlatans everywhere in this field. Folks who are out trying to take credit for carbon reduction are not, in general, following the very careful approaches and holistic accounting that is required to be able to make this work without the negative impacts that might be associated. And that's all. Thank you.
Thanks so much for that, Burke. So next we'll do another poll question and then move to our final speaker. In the meantime, feel free to add any questions for Burke or Andrew to the question box in the control panel. All right, so this question will help inform the creation of a new mCDR research node in the California current. system. It looks like maybe the first part of the answer got cut off with some of the examples. All right, thanks so much everyone for your responses. We can probably close that poll question soon. Appreciate it. All right, I'll introduce our final speaker, Dr. Debora Iglesias-Rodriguez. Debora is a professor of biological oceanography and chair of the Department of Ecology, Evolution, and Marine Biology at the University of California, Santa Barbara. Her research interests include biological impacts of ocean acidification and more recently, ocean alkalinity enhancement with a focus on marine phytoplankton. She was an author of the National Academy's Research Strategy for Ocean-Based Carbon Dioxide Removal and Sequestration, and is on the leadership team of Ocean Visions. Debora, I will pass it to you when you're ready.
Here we are. So it's great to be here. And I'd like to thank the organizers, Darcy, Lauren, and Alex for the opportunity to present the results of my lab and give my perspective, offer my perspective on ocean alkalinity enhancement. So the title really reflects the focus of the next 15, 20 minutes. And I'm going to be talking about the results of an experiment that we published a few months ago in June. And I think this is the most exciting time in our professional lives when we found essentially no impact on of our manipulation. So we found neutral responses, and this is really a glimpse of hope, question mark. So before I get started, we go to next slide, please. And again, so we have, I just wanted to bring up this, these two slides, and Burke and Andrew made reference to this, and this is from the National Academy's report. So on the land we have the impact of essentially mining, which is associated with just two minerals. So we need to mine the mineral, crush, pulverize the mineral, sometimes industrial transformations, transportation, storage, and eventually deployment. And this comes at a cost, an environmental cost, and is energetically expensive. So we hope that working together with the engineering community is going to make these processes less environmentally costly, less energetically costly, and easier. And we have had little success when we try to dissolve minerals. We've tried olivine, we've tried different derivatives of limestone, and we also tried brucite recently. And we either got partial dissolution, and dissolution rates, the kinetics of dissolution, very, very extremely small. So this is really a problem. Now, when we talk about liquid alkalinity, which is represented on the right in the C component of ocean alkalinity enhancement, I mean, it's in a way mining as well. There is a byproduct, which is hydrochloric acid that we need to get rid of, and that can be problematic as well. But there are concerns about using some of the, all of the solid phase ground rock when we add it to the ocean, because there are processes like flocculation, aggregation, impacts through the water column, like light penetration close to the surface, increase in export flux, and essentially loss of alkalinity at the surface, which is exactly the opposite of what we try to achieve. And there could be ecological implications, including the ingestion of these particles by grazers and so on. So we are really trying to explore different levels of organization, how ocean alkalinity enhancement affects, the chemical, the chemistry, the CDR potential, but also the biology. And if we move to the next slide, and I should say that our work is focused primarily on right now exclusively on phytoplankton, on photosynthetic organisms, and previous slide, please. Thank you. And we have this equilibria here that Andrew made reference to. And when we add alkalinity to the ocean, we push these reactions to the right. And bicarbonate ions are, the increasing bicarbonate ions do not appear to be a concern for, in terms of productivity and photosynthesis in general, because the vast majority of photosynthetic organisms in the oceans have acquired over evolutionary timescales pretty sophisticated ways to acquire carbon species other than CO2, and most of them are well adapted to utilize bicarbonate ions. So if we move to the next slide, please. Okay, so what do we do in my lab? We run lab experiments and manipulation and mesocosm manipulations, the lab experiments. And if you click again on the slide, or if you click on the figure on the left, there is a little video so you can actually see the bottles bubbling. So if you move the cursor there you go. So you can see, we introduce bubbling to equilibrate the CO2 in the air phase with the CO2 in seawater. And we, so this is very gentle bubbling. This has followed tests, looking at the effect of bubbling on the fate of the cells. And so we try to minimize other effects. Like, for example, we usually add nutrients to our manipulation so that we don't have any confounding effect of nutrient limitation, for example, in our experiments. On the left, in the lab experiments, we use strains from species that are really well known, and we typically use representatives that have been isolated from the waters relatively recently. And then on the right, we use a subset of the community from out there. So we do some filtration to remove major grazers, so that we can actually look at the outcome of in terms of diversity. And we use these plexiglass tanks where we bathe bottles, polycarbonate bottles. In this case, I think it's 10-liter polycarbonate bottles, and we run a line from the Santa Barbara Channel, so we keep everything in the temperature that the populations would experience from out there. We introduce light filtration with these blue filters to mimic light levels that they would experience in the chlorophyll max. So this is what we, roughly the way we conduct our experiments. So if we go to the next slide, please. Okay, so why looking at phytoplankton? So, all the animals in the ocean that undergo a larval stage, they need phytoplankton biomass, and they need nutritionally nutritionally good quality phytoplanktonic cells. So typically it means high nitrogen to carbon ratios. Anyway, they need specific types of phytoplankton in their diet and enough sufficient biomass for their diets. The phytoplankton is responsible for about half of the net primary production on planetary scales. It draws down, phytoplankton draw down CO2, so they fulfill a very important ecosystem service, and they produce oxygen, and many functional groups fulfill unique functions like fixing CO2, some phytoplankton like the dinoflagellates that you can see on the bottom left can be toxic or produce light. And we have focused on the ones on the right, at the bottom right, you can see a colony of nitrogen fixers. We have focused on diatoms that you can see at the top left, and coccolithophores on the top right that are biomineral producers. So diatoms produce silica, and coccolithophores produce calcium carbonate. So these are two important organisms from a primary production point of view, and they are key in not exactly governing, but their matter is exported to depth as they bloom every year, and they are important primary producers. And through the production of these biominerals, specifically calcium carbonate, that's an important way by which Earth controls the CO2 fluxes between the atmosphere, the upper ocean, and the ocean interior. So, extremely important biogeochemically and ecophysiologically as well. Okay, next slide, please. And I wanted to show this slide just to, I think Burke mentioned the Bering Sea. So coccolithophores are very prominent in the Bering Sea. They form blooms. We published this paper in 2018 in JGR Oceans with Carol Ladd as the lead author. And you know, she studied through remote sensing techniques, these blooms, these coccolithophore blooms, in relation to the environmental conditions, and we looked at stratification and a number of things. And we have these, coccolithophores have been the focus of our attention, but diatoms are really important, and they appear together in the seasonal dynamics, in the annual succession of blooms. Typically, diatoms bloom, and these blooms are followed by coccolithophores, so they occupy distinct niches, and to understand the effects on these two organisms is very interesting. Next slide, please. So when I think about alkalinization, and when we started these experiments, I have a background on ocean acidification, and these experiments are actually quite challenging in many ways and quite different. And it also made me think about the phycological literature that for, you know, the 30, 40, 50 years prior to the discovery of ocean acidification, we conducted experiments under really high pH values because the cell densities that we targeted were extremely high. So pH values of around 9 were not atypical in our experiments. So what I did is I picked a couple of examples, and this is in a way, you know, a similar example to what Burke showed with the hatchery industry. So here we have an example from Danish waters, and Petersen and Hansen looked at chlorophyll, phytoplankton biomass, so you can see that at the top. I'm moving my mouse, but I realize that you cannot see that. And then at the bottom, we have diatom biomass, and at the bottom right, you have dinoflagellate biomass. And you can see that up to pH 9, there is an increase in these parameters. And then pH 9, there is the highest pH is 9.5, and under these values, you know, performance appears to decline. But there is alkalinization. We have quite a lot of data on alkalinization of seawater and examples of phytoplankton. To look at the data from these experiments, we can look at artifacts just because of the way we run the experiments in and naturally high cell densities. But we can, it's interesting also to look at trends in seawater. This is from coastal waters from the same group from Hansen in 2002. And you can see the fluctuations in pH over months, over an annual cycle, and this corresponds to 10 years. And you can see that there are ups and downs, and the fluctuations can be pretty extreme. And then they looked also at the relative abundance and the growth rates of species. In this case, they looked at two dinoflagellates, and they looked at, they found this deviation in growth with increasing pH. And this, the graph on the right, at the bottom right, corresponds to the pH to the graph on the left, and I'm looking at the right side of the figure. Sorry, this is I'm again using my mouse, but I realize that you cannot see that. So the take-home message of this slide, I guess, is that alkalinization per se, up to reasonable values within natural variability, is probably not a concern for phytoplankton. But it is likely that there might be selection for species or relative, some species may have an advantage with respect to other species. So we might see changes in the community composition following alkalinization. So that remains to be seen. And this is part of the work that we are doing in my group, is to try and look at alterations in community structure following ocean alkalinity enhancement. Let's go to the next slide, please. Okay, so now I'm going to dive into a paper that was led by one of my PhD students, James Gately, with contributions from Sylvia Kim, my lab specialist, and Ben Jean, who is a graduate student in my lab, and Mark Brzezinski, who is an expert in diatoms at UCSB. And we made a cover of the issue, and it's beautiful, and I just want to share that. Let's go to the next slide, please. So let's dive in the, into the methodology. So we used a limestone-inspired ocean alkalinity enhancement approach. And what this means is that we did not deal with the solubility issues or the kinetics of this mineral dissolution, but rather we tried to mimic as well as we possibly could the chemistry of limestone dissolution. So we added sodium carbonate and calcium chloride, and we added also nutrients, so nitrogen, phosphorus sources, and vitamins to avoid any confounding effect of, for example, nutrient limitation. The way we did this was we went out there and got seawater, filtered that to remove biological contaminate or the biology, and then we aliquoted out volumes like what you see you saw on the video for the lab experiments, and we bubbled with air containing current present day partial pressures of CO2. Let's go to the next slide, please. So again, the aim was to look at responses in Emiliania haxelii, and so this is the representative of coccolithophores and a silica producer, which was a species of Catoceros, which is they are both ecologically important species representatives. And we looked at physiological parameters and biogeochemically relevant parameters following alkalinity. The values that we use, we aim for 3,000 and 5,000 micromoles of alkalinity, total alkalinity per kilogram of seawater, and this meant adding approximately 750 and 2,800 micromoles per kilogram of seawater, enhancing the seawater. And this was following recommendations from by Phil Ranforth and Gideon Henderson in 2017. Next slide, please. So I'm going to look at the main results. And so the first one I want to show you is growth. So when we looked at the growth of coccolithophores and diatoms, we did not see any significant difference in the growth. So here we have the logarithm of cell density on the y-axis and time. We conducted these experiments for between four and five days. Next slide, please. And I should say that the cultures were, the cells were in the exponential phase of growth during this period. These are all the physiological and biochemical data that we looked at, and it includes particulate organic carbon and nitrogen, particulate inorganic carbon, which essentially is calcium carbonate, the particulate inorganic carbon to particulate organic carbon ratio, and the particulate organic carbon to the particulate organic nitrogen ratio. So these are ratios that are used commonly in oceanographic or as biochemical proxies for example, the peak to poke ratio is an important proxy for looking at whether systems are sources or sinks of CO2, and POC and PON are indicative of growth, and PIC of calcification and so on. So there was one, let's go down one slide again. There was one parameter that, and up, please. There was one parameter, the FV over FM. Let's go to the previous slide, please. The FV over FM, which you can see at the bottom right, that show small, under 3% differences between the low and the high alkalinity treatment, but significantly, consistently significantly different. And we don't know why there is a decline in these values, because this is not reflected in growth or in the POC production. And the values for FV over FM are typically associated with healthy cells. Nevertheless, this is, you know, we found a difference in the FV over FM. Let's move to the next slide, please. And we found kind of the same with diatoms. We looked at POC, PON, and instead of calcium carbonate production, we looked at biogenic silica and ratios of biogenic silica to POC and PON. And then if we go next to next slide, please, you can see that, well, I'm telling you, you cannot actually see that, but the FV over FM results were very similar to the results that we found with coccolithophores. So we found under 3% difference between the high and the low treatment and alkalinity treatment. And again, very small differences, but significantly different. Relatively high values. Now, the formation of secondary precipitates, this is something that we found under high alkalinity conditions in some treatments. And what we did is we looked at the dissolved nutrients in the water, in addition to looking at these spectroscopy images. So the one that you can see at the top, or number one slide, is scanning electron micrograph of the precipitate that we found. We found this type of precipitate in the media and in the cultures. And then we have the different elements and the relative abundance of these elements represented by the color bar that is next to each image. So that you can see, carbon, number two, number three, iron, and so on and so forth. So you can see, for example, that silicon is a big component of these aggregates. We also found phosphorus to be part of these aggregates, and iron, and so on. So if we go to the next slide, please, and I'm showing you an example of the dissolved nutrients of silicate in the medium. So we have here dissolved silicate in the medium in the control at the top in yellow, and then you can see in green the values for moderate alkalinity treatment, which was the intermediate treatment, and then the high alkalinity treatment with the lowest dissolved silicate value. So the big concern here is, okay, so if alkalinization is removing some nutrients from seawater, you know, is this a big concern for the selection for species that require those particular nutrients? Can we devise a method that adds alkalinity, can we increase this alkalinity thresholds and prevent secondary precipitation through methodology approaches and you know, methods to add alkalinity, essentially. Next slide, please. So what I wanted to tell you about the experiments that we are currently doing in the lab. So what we are doing is running mesocosm experiments. We have looked at two groups in isolation. What we want to do is look at the community composition, changes in diversity, and using the Santa Barbara channel as a natural lab, if you like, to look at the effect of upwelling. You know, so we have looked at relaxation of upwelling and a period when with relaxed upwelling, a period of upwelling in the spring of 2023. And in a couple of weeks, my team led by James is going to run a mesocosm experiment to try and get a sense of how you know, this alkalinization of seawater could be affected at different times of the year. And this is an example of you can see the temperature, the differences in temperature during an upwelling period in the right compared to the summer period. Next slide, please. We are almost there. And we have looked at diversity in a couple of mesocosm experiments that we run, and we will be looking at diversity in collecting samples for DNA metabarcoding analysis. So this uses amplicon sequence variants, which are highly conserved regions of the genome that vary depending on the species. So we can go down to genus and in some cases species. So we want to essentially look at winners and losers, for the lack of a better, a more elegant way of describing the potential outcomes. One of my former students, Dylan Cutlett, optimized this methodology, developing mock communities for the Santa Barbara Channel, and we have a paper which is coming out in Proceedings of the Royal Society, looking at this method. And the last one, I think. So there is a great potential for OAE. you know, I won't go over what I just mentioned, but there are other considerations that I'm not touching on, like ecological security, criteria and principles to determine what constitutes an acceptable outcome. And I think I will leave it there. And I'll go to the last slide to thank the organizations that made this work possible. If we go to the last slide, please. So we have been funded by generously by the Climate Works Foundation, the Carbon to Sea Initiative, the Coastal Fund, and the Pat Tillman Foundation. And I'd like to thank you all for your patience waiting for my presentation. Thank you.
Thanks, Debora, and thanks everyone for sticking around and bearing with those technical difficulties. So I think with the few minutes left, we have gotten so many great questions and also have one more quick poll question to inform our future webinars. We certainly want to have more on this topic of OAE and on other mCDR topics given all this interest. All right, I think we can wrap up the poll. Thank you all. We'll take that all into consideration and announce the next webinar soon. And I'll pass it to Darcy. Maybe we have time for one more question for our, with quick answers for our panelists.
It's hard to find a quick answer question with this topic. We've had so many great questions come in. I think this is going to help us structure our next webinar, which will be going back into ocean alkalinity enhancement so we can address some of the topics that people have brought up. One that maybe we'll just pose to all the speakers for just a very quick first blush is there's some cautionary talks on ocean alkalinity enhancement, a recent push for mCDR solutions. Should the scientific community address the enthusiasm of the CDR industry who believes that OAE is a definitive solution? And there's some follow-up questions to that as well, but I guess I'll leave it that one for now. Anybody want to weigh in on that before we go?
You go ahead, Andrew.
I just cynically note that if there's money in it, there will be an industry to do it. And so if you want to make it feel that there should not be money in it, us as scientists are probably not your trigger point.
I think that we should play the honest broker and remain, you know, the scientists in this process. I think the private sector has to be guided by us, by scientists. And I'm worried about our limitations at the moment in conducting MRVs, like something that Burke mentioned and Andrew alluded to. And so I am a supporter of research, of conducting research, but it remains to be seen whether we can do it.
Thanks, Debora. Burke, any final thoughts or thoughts on that question?
Yeah, I think we should encourage honesty in our approaches to this solving this problem. I think the idea that we can't engineer some level of mitigation is overly negative. But I think it's critically important for those of us who are in these fields to understand the impacts and understand the end-to-end results of these approaches need to be open and transparent and honest with the communities.
Great. Thank you. Thank you again to our three fantastic speakers today. And thank you all so much for attending the webinar. We would welcome any feedback or further questions or suggestions for topics for the series. And we'll email out the updates and announcements that were shared in the chat today. And then a recording of the webinar will be available on the CCAN OA, Alaska OA Network and OST websites. And we'll send an email announcing the next webinar soon. So thanks everybody, have a great Friday.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.